Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Kay Bennecoff, your host from the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen, and I'm so happy to say that we're going to visit Angela in the Serricca studios. And there she is. Hi, Angela. How are you?
Hey, Kay.
I'm so glad we're together again today, okay?
And me too.
It's been a little time making. Thanks to Zoom and the wonderful staff at BCTV, we are having our show tonight. Okay, so Angela, like I said, it's Serricca Studios, and she is a very artistic craftsman and jewelry maker, and she's going to tell us how she got started.
I've always enjoyed creating and making things with my hands ever since I was a kid. I had quite a few different influences, grandparents, my nanny, who's my dad's mom. She was big into baking and then also doing crafts. We would hang out with her like a lot of weekends and doing all kinds of fun projects that she would clip out of magazines and whatnot. So I always enjoyed doing crafts with her. And then on my other side of the family, my Grammy and Grandpa, they were into oil painting for a little while. So I learned about painting through them. Her mom, my great-grandmother, great-grammy Haight, she was into knitting and crocheting. So I got exposure to that. And she would make little outfits for my Barbie dolls and stuff like that. So I was always exposed to art. So that was always an influence for me and an interest to me. When I was younger, I was big into making beaded jewelry and those knotted friendship bracelets with the embroidery floss. On my website, I even have a picture when I was about 10. I was at a farmer's market with a little card table set up selling my friendship bracelets and anklets for like a dollar or something like that. And that was all thanks to my parents, who had a hobby shop for most of my childhood. And so I had that entrepreneurial background and experience and exposure from hanging out there when I wasn't at school or with friends and being around that small business atmosphere as well.
Yeah. Well, it's certainly genetic, I think, right? You know, and jewelry's been your passion since you were 10. So
yeah. I always enjoyed it, making things for given as gifts or just wearing and decorating myself.
Yeah.
Later on, realized in high school that when a recruiter came from Tyler School of Art to talk about art school, I realized I could go to college for that. And I was like, wow, all right. So 11th grade, I started visiting different colleges and learning more about it. And I ended up going to Tyler, and I really enjoyed that experience. I ended up double majoring. I would have majored in everything if I could, but I stuck to jewelry and sculpture, dimensional 3D arts, which is something I also enjoyed in high school, like the weaving and basket making department and ceramics. That was all departments that I really enjoyed in high school. So 3D arts was always my thing.
Well, I'm sure your art teacher from, you went to Boyertown, right?
Class of 03.
Yes. Oh my goodness. I thought you just graduated a few years ago. Well, it was just a few years ago, actually, right? And I'm sure your art teacher is very pleased with what you've done, you know, with your art.
I had great teachers. I had Benfield, I had Wagner, I had Osterberry. They were all great teachers. So they helped influence me to the next step.
Yes. And you just couldn't get away from that sculpting though thing, right? You
know, No. And I was still really drawn to the metal part of sculpture. Yeah. So learning how to weld and a little bit of TIGing and stick welding and kind of forming and cutting. So It was still metals when I was like focusing my last 2 years in college, once I declared those majors. So that was kind of like my thing. And then patinas and what else you could do with metal besides shape it and cut it and form it and fuse it. And so you'll see in my work, like, I also like playing around with textures and patinas, which are reactions on the surface. And then copper is great too, because you can enamel it. So I'll talk about all that.
Yeah, so you're a bit of a mathematician, a scientist.
Yeah, not an expert by any means in any of those fields, but I dabble in it a little here and there, yeah.
So this just proves why we are in high school and why we're exposed to all of the different subjects we are, where we think we're going to use that again, and voila, right? You know,
right. Thank goodness for Google.
And that is true too, right? Yes. And that's probably more apparent to all the students out there having to have finished their high school and their elementary. My goodness, you know, they've all been on virtual school for the last how many months?
You're always learning. And I love the art community too, because they're so supportive. Like, you go to shows and you're helping each other out with your setup or giving input on your display. Mm-hmm. And now with Facebook, you have like Facebook groups that you can follow in. Like, I'm in an enameling group, I'm in a piercing group, and you just like share your projects and what you learn. And it's just so great. I love it. The support's amazing.
Yeah, it's a great community, you know, like you said, and you pick up things from other people and you share. And I mean, you just keep growing in your in art then all the time, and sharing ideas. But the other side to that is just getting good friendships too, you know.
Right, absolutely.
Yeah. So you became a juried member of Reading Berks Guild. So you're one of our more recently juried members. Right. And so glad to have you. Yes. But in between, I know you don't want to talk a whole lot about it, but you were a photographer, right? You know,
after college, I was double majoring, and I was so focused on getting out of there in 4 years, because that was what I could afford. That I didn't really think of the next step. I did arrange to have like an apprenticeship under a sculptor in Quakertown. He's called Steve Tobin Studios. So I hung out with him for a summer and learned about how he operates his business and how he creates his work, and got to know his people. And then I kind of got into different fields after that, job-wise, where I was making money.
Yeah.
One of them ended up being picture people, where I was taking portraits of families in a studio in a mall. So I started that out, and then kind of became an addiction. I stayed in that field job wise, taking pictures, then getting involved at Dance Camera City as like their one of their ops coordinators, doing photo booths and Santa pictures and all that fun stuff. So it's in my blood, and it really stuck to when my nanny passed, because she was always like the photographer in the family, always had the camera, had to get that Kodak moment. So when she passed, that really like stuck with me too, where I felt like this is in my blood, and I still keep up with it for friends and family and referrals, doing photos on the side, another aspect of my business.
Yeah. Well, when you're as talented as you are, you can just keep going.
Just pop around. You'll have many trades.
That's awesome. Well, like I said, it's always so nice to be able to get down and get to know the artist up close and personal. Okay, so now we're going to get down to the nitty gritty here. Okay, right?
Yeah.
Tell us what we're going to do first. Okay?
Well, I do have a variety of finishes that I will go over, but when I get down to the basics, the process that I use to create my pieces, such as this bracelet that I'm wearing, and as you can see, it's like dimensional. It's got a pop-up. Yes. Mm-hmm. I call it pop-up jewelry. It's all nature themed currently, so mostly floral patterns. Mm-hmm. And the basic starting point and technique that I use is called piercing and sawing. And what you do is you start out with a piece of metal.
And what metal is that, Angela?
I'm sorry?
What kind of metal is that?
Oh, I'm sorry. This is copper. I use copper for all of my work. It's affordable. It's got this wonderful warm tone that I just love. It was actually the accent metal in my wedding. Very DIY.
Nice.
So it was copper and rustic themed. So I love copper. There's a lot you can do with it besides texturing it. You can do a patina finish. You can enamel it. It's very fun to work with. So I have a little copper circle here.
Okay.
And what I do is I first pierce it in by drilling holes. So you can see like little holes in the middle of it.
Okay.
And then I will use a fine tooth jeweler's saw blade in a coping saw, which I'll show you, and saw out the design.
Oh, how pretty. Yeah, it looks beautiful.
Still flat.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the piercing and the sawing. And then I take it a step further for my signature design, signature look and style, and pop it up.
Oh, yes.
So
yep.
So then it's dimensional.
Yes.
And then I have different processes on how I finish the edges, work hard in it so it doesn't move around. And then here's an example of it then enameled. And vitreous enamel is a fine glass powder that I fuse to the metal in my kiln here. Blue.
You said
adopted.
You said that's powder that you use.
Is right. Enamel
powder. Okay.
So it's a fine glass powder.
Okay.
That you sift onto the surface. It goes into the kiln and it will fuse to the metal. So you got that nice glass surface.
Okay.
So that's enameling, which I have a lot of my work finished as. Mm-hmm. So let me just show you. This is my little cute little drill press. You can also use a jeweler's flex shaft, which is like a Dremel. With this forgiving, flexible cord, very handheld.
Mm-hmm.
But I found this is much better for accuracy because what I do use when I pierce is a really, really tiny drill bit. I don't know if we'll be able to see the comparison. So this is like a typical set of
drill bits.
This is my teeny tiny little guy.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, so he's really fine. He's like, I think this is a 0.8 millimeter. So it's just big enough to fit the saw blade through.
Wow.
So I'm going to get a little loud here.
Okay.
Safety first. So
yes.
Drill presses spin and it's not good if you catch your hair in it. So I'm going to do that.
Oh, that is very good. See, this is something you'd never see at a show, right?
No. And then I got the space shield too, just in case it happens to ricochet. I don't want to.
Good lessons here today. Thank you, Angela.
So I have my pattern on my metal.
Okay. So you showed us that.
Little marks where I'm going to drill. And I'm going to drill out my holes. And just to give you an idea, I just drilled out all those holes so it's punched.
Okay.
And then let me take this off. This is the jeweler's coping saw. And as you can see, it's got a really fine.
Again, very.
Even not saw blade. It just looks like a piece of string.
It does.
Really, really, really tiny teeth on it.
Yes. Oh my.
So what I'll do is I'll feed it up through.
I am like looking so close here, Angela.
I know, I'm sorry. My camera's not the best.
No, it's wonderful. It shows, you know, our viewers at home how tiny things that you're making tiny pieces of jewelry, but how tiny your tools are.
Yeah. Thankfully, my eyes are still pretty good. I mean, I got glasses, but no magnifying glasses needed yet. So that is pierced through. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to saw along my design to cut it out.
Okay.
So I'll just quick do that at my little bench pin over here.
Okay.
Yeah. And I gotta go nice and slow, let the teeth do all the work cutting, because if I rush it too fast, it might snap the saw blade. If I twist it too fast, it might cut the saw blade. And I use some wax here to kind of help it glide along.
Okay. Now that's very interesting, you know. And so this takes great practice. When you first are starting to do this,
hand-eye coordination. Yep, practice makes better.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
Can you see it?
Yeah. Yeah. No. I can see it. Yes.
It's somewhere there.
Yep.
That's the piercing and sawing part. Mm-hmm. Once I do it all, I'll pop it up, I'll finish the edges, and then I'll decide what kind of finish I'm going to do. That's usually the order of the process.
Okay, so you have to kind of like sand those edges then, is that what
Yeah, because they have like little burrs
that might cut you. Mm-hmm. Right, yeah. Right. Yes, because your pieces are exquisite, you know, like when I bought my daughter a beautiful bracelet for her birthday from you, and it's it's so smooth. It's just, you know.
It's my perfect. Biggest fear is someone getting cut by it. Smooth edges. I go over every little edge, and I also seal all the edges too. So pieces like this have a hammer texture.
Okay. Yeah, they're just so beautiful. Yep, it's very pretty.
So there's like a bunch of little dimples and dots in the surface of the metal. So I call that the hammered texture. Mm-hmm. And that is my one collection that I have where it just keeps the copper its beautiful, shiny, warm tone and kind of adds a little extra sparkle with the hammered texture in addition to the dimension of the pop-up. Okay. So that is how that looks.
Yeah, so that means that you're not putting that in your kiln because you're keeping the copper color and keeping copper in its the way it is.
Correct. I keep it the way it is. And then on top of that, these are all sealed with a material called Protective Clear, which is used for like architectural and sculptural applications where it seals in either the bare copper or even the patinas that I use and preserves them. It's like a 3 or 4 layer process. It takes time for drying in between, but it'll help protect the pieces, which is great. It keeps them the way I want them.
Well, right. So it stays in that because naturally metals would change over because of the atmosphere, right?
Right. Atmosphere, even just oxygen will tarnish or oxidize the metal surface. It's reacting with the metal particle, the molecules. And so that's why you get tarnish and patina. Right. Sometimes you'll get fun patina finishes, like this verdigris type patina, which can occur naturally in nature. It just takes a really long time. This, I use a pre-purchased solution that reacts a little faster, but is still a build-up process. So I'll paint it on the metal surface, let it dry, and keep building it up until I get what I want. End result wise.
Okay. And that's the verdigris, you know, so pretty, you know, but like you said, that would naturally occur, but it could take years for it to get like that if you didn't have that speed up process. Beautiful. It is. It's so beautiful.
And then this is created with liver sulfur. It's more of an oxidized type patina. Built up again with layers to get that nice solid dark.
Oh yeah.
Finish. I don't know. I have it dark on dark. I'm sorry, but there you go. You can kind of see it.
Yeah. No. Yeah. It's so pretty, you know. And so you like experiment with these different things too, you know.
I do.
Here again, science, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, in college I did a whole study, and unfortunately I don't know what I did with it, but I'm meaning to revisit how to create my own patinas with different solutions of like salt water or with there's different materials. I don't remember them off the top of my head, but for now I'm using the pre-bought stuff. But
right.
It is a process.
Yeah. And I'm sure you'll experiment with them, you know, as your years go on here, you know, in your studio and stuff, and you'll come up with some miraculous things, I know.
Right. Yeah. If I remember correctly, with like salt, something with salt has like this beautiful blue patina on copper. So yeah, there's so many options.
Yeah. It just goes on and on. So, okay. Well, I didn't want to take you off track there, but you know.
Oh, it's okay. Okay. Here's another fun hammered piece. This is a bigger statement piece with some little dangle leaves with some motion.
Okay. Yeah.
Kinetic motion going there. I love, it's a fun piece to wear.
Yeah. For sure. And what metal was that? Was that, that was mixed metal on that one, right?
This is actually all copper. So this is copper wire that is hand twisted and formed to look like a little leaf.
Okay.
Now the difference between this is when I first started the collection, I was using copper chain just to keep with the copper theme. However, these are not sealed. So they include a polishing cloth, which I can show you a quick little sample of how to polish a copper chain and other ways of cleaning copper. Some people don't want that. They don't want it to change. They don't want to have to clean it. So I started offering this nice clean stainless steel option, which is also hypoallergenic.
Oh, okay.
So that's an option that I now have.
Yeah.
Most of my necklaces now come with the stainless steel and come in like a 22 inch, but you can always request a different length.
Mm-hmm.
So here is a bracelet that has a copper chain.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. And as you can see, it's a little dark and tarnished.
Mm-hmm.
So when you get a piece like that, I include a polishing cloth, and it's basically infused with like a polishing compound and it has a little bit of a grit to it to get like the debris off. Mm-hmm. And then it also kind of reseals it for a little bit. So all you do is brush this up, rub it so it shines again.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll turn your...
I know. I think most ladies who have bought jewelry over the years have received one of those cloths here or there, you know, with everything. And so, yeah. Now, can you wash those cloths? I'm just asking.
I don't think so, because once you use up the compound, you're just stuck with like a dirty cloth with all the black, which is fine. And the black means that you're cleaning it. But once it's completely black, it's pretty much done.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. But you can always order them more. I think like they sell on Amazon and whatnot.
Yeah. No, that's fine. I just thought I never saw instructions that you could wash it or anything.
Yeah. And then not that I'm aware of.
No. And with you talking about it makes perfect sense that you wouldn't, because, you know, you've used everything that's on there, you know, once that's totally.
Right. Yeah. And that works for like silver too, that tarnishes. Mm-hmm. So it's universal. Some other fun things that you can use household-wise to clean copper, vinegar.
Oh.
Ketchup has a little bit of vinegar.
Oh, okay.
Lemon or lime juice.
Oh, okay.
Acid stuff will remove the oxidation. It's good if you mix this with baking soda, too. So then you have a mild abrasive to kind of help as well. But these they'll last for a little while, and then you'll have to like re-clean them. But those are some easy ways to clean anything copper that you have that's not sealed.
Well, thanks for those tips there, Angela.
I had fun experimenting back in May when I hosted a virtual in-studio kind of show, and I had like different topics I touched on. So if you go on my Facebook page and look for that, there's more in-depth demo with that. So it's fun. Yeah. You never know what you have lying around the house.
Right. Serricca Studios.
Yeah.
.com, right? Yes. Your website's beautiful too.
Oh, so thank you.
People just want to go there and look at all your wonderful things, you know.
Here, I made a little sign. SerriccaStudios.com.
That's perfect. That's perfect. Okay.
So we talked about the hammer texture.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We talked about the patinas. Next is enameling. And that's that fun powder that I was talking to you about, the glass powder.
Yes.
You sift it onto the material. The two finishes that I like to use are clear and white. The clear is great because it's transparent. It reveals the copper still layered below that it's fused to. Mm-hmm. And then I like to give it a little contrast and have that black patina applied to any of the edges and the soldered bail and whatnot. So it has that contrast and a little bit of pop.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. It's lovely.
And then with the white, I tend to keep the edges coppery. So there's shimmer.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah. It's like a little more dressy, you know, I mean.
Yeah.
It gives you a little sparkle.
Yeah, I would say this goes with a lot. It does dress up and it is more simple. I mean, match pretty much everything with white. This I would say is a little more earthy, good mm-hmm. with like earthy colors and hair colors and skin tones and whatnot. And both work great in the summer. This is maybe better for winter months, so fall. So you can like mix it up.
That's what I was going to say. I think with, the wearable art, you can, whatever you feel, you know,
right.
You know, and people like to just come up with their own ideas with it too. So, you know, I mean, I think they'd wear it every day, no matter what they're wearing.
I hope so.
I think so. Yes.
So that's the base of the enameling. And what I'll quick show to you again, with the enameling, you have the fine glass powder. And just real quick to show.
Yeah, please.
This is called a trivet.
Oh, okay.
And a little tray here that holds it. And then the piece kind of rests on the points there.
Okay.
So it's just touching on the edges, because if it touches anywhere else, as the powder melts and fuses, it would stick to the trivet. So okay. That kind of suspends it and keeps it level, so it melts and fuses nice and evenly, and that's how it goes into the kiln. I have like this fork that I scoop up, put it in the kiln, and then when it's done and hot and glowing, take it out and let it cool.
How do you get the enamel dust on there?
So you use one of these little sifters.
Oh, okay.
This is a smaller sifter on a handle. There's like bigger ones for bigger pieces. They come in different grid sizes.
Oh, okay.
Because this actually comes in different grits. kind of like sandpaper. Different meshes. I'm sorry. They call it mesh, but sandpaper is considered grit. So they come in different sizes depending on the application. Sometimes you need it really fine. Sometimes you need it chunkier. So you'll scoop it and then sift it onto the piece and then put it into the oven. Basically, that's the basic.
Mm-hmm.
Catch of it all, but that's how that works.
Well, I never would have known about how enameled pieces got enameled. Yeah,
that's one of the processes. There's actually a variety of processes. Some include channels that you fill with enamel. Others you build up walls. There's even a process, and I don't remember which one's which, but there's one where you actually have cut out metal. And you'll fill it with the glass, with the enamel, and it ends up kind of looking like a stained glass. That's beautiful. Mm-hmm. I'm not to that level yet, but there's a variety of enameling techniques that's just amazing. And there's some beautiful work out there.
Well, you'll just go on and on. So
I'll get there eventually.
You'll get there. Yes, yes. I mean, you know.
Yep, always learning, always learning.
Yeah, yeah. And and experimenting, you know, here again. So. Right. All you kids out there, pay attention in those science classes and those math classes, right?
Right. So that's a little example. And then this is the kiln that it goes into. So I kiln fire my enamel before I got this guy used, because they're not cheap. I was torch firing, which is possible. I found it tricky to do bigger pieces, which I wanted to start doing statement pieces, and you have to keep that flame going and keep it evenly heated for it to all fuse at the same time. So yeah, Eventually, okay. I was like, I splurged on a used kiln. I bought him from North Carolina, and I love him.
Okay. Oh, so you torched that prior to using the kiln.
Right.
Yeah. So it's the same thing, but just with an open flame then, right?
Right, right. It's tricky. Yeah.
I was going to say, so that's another thing that you had to practice a lot with, you know, doing that. So that kiln was a huge help to you in doing that. So can you put more than one piece in there at a time or not?
You can. There's actually fun little, different kinds of trivets. There's this one, there's a wavy one where you can line up a bunch or do a couple. This comes in handy with some of the bigger ones. I tend to do them one at a time just to be like extra cautious. Because that's the last step. I'm piercing, I'm sawing, I'm forming, I'm fixing the edges, I'm sifting the enamel on each side. I do both sides because you really should always enamel both sides because it will like warp the metal if you don't. So it helps keep its structure. So I do both sides and then anything can go wrong at any stage, but when it's the last stage, that's always the worst. Start over.
Yeah, you're not going to risk that. Well, you don't risk anything because you take your time in all your processes. Everything comes out so beautifully, you know.
Hey.
Yeah, no. Is there any other process you want to get show us here yet today?
There is one more stage beyond the enameling, and that's something that I've been experimenting with ever since I took a class, I think it was 2 years ago. It is watercolor enamel. So here's one piece here, and here's another piece here, and I just paired it up with other earrings. So this sunflower piece has red petals and like a brown center.
Mm-hmm.
I did it a little bit of an ombre type style. So it's a little lighter, medium, and darker. And then I just paired it with plain white square earrings. So you can mix and match.
Mm-hmm.
But this is all hand painted with special watercolor enamel paints, which I will do a quick little demo for you. And I love it because not only is it popping up, but you can make it pop even more, have some color, make it more fun.
Yeah, it's beautiful. So you're going to show us how you do that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's do that.
Okay. Now, I know you were going to show us something about hammering too, so I just wanted to make sure that, you know, I don't want to mess you up here.
Let's do the watercolor.
Watercolor? Okay. Here we go.
We're on that topic. So this is a new thing that I've been playing around with.
Ooh.
End of last year. Barrettes.
Barrettes. I was going to ask you, it looked like a barrette. Okay.
I have a couple different styles that I'm playing around with for barrettes. And as you can see, I started painting
an
orangey color on that one flower there. I have a bunch of others. So it's special little watercolor paint. Similar technique. You use water. You kind of build it up. So layer by layer, lighter to dark. And
okay. Yep. You go blown, ahead.
Blown out lighting wise.
Yeah. No, that's fine. We don't want you to mess it up.
That's okay. I won't be firing this. It will rub off until I fire it.
Oh, okay. So you can, we still don't want to mess it up.
Tweak it. But I love it because I can build it up. I can add like more texture and streaky paint brushes to it. I can mix in layers of color.
Yeah. So even though you do the same design, you may do the same design, every piece is individual. It's unique because, you know, you stroke it this way and you know, it's like flowers, like not one is alike, you know, like.
Right. Yeah. And that's the other nice thing about hand cutting and why I pride myself in hand cutting all my work. When I go to shows, quite often I get people asking, what punch do I use? What stamp do I use? Is it chopped in a like hydraulic press or anything like that? And I tell them it's hand cut and they look at me like I'm crazy. But I love it because it's very hands-on. And if that did exist, they would all be very production looking, very much all the same, same, same. With this, if you look at it close, not all petals are perfect. My template's perfect because it was kind of computer generated, but when I cut them, they're all just slightly wonky at times and it just looks more natural.
Because one person did it. It wasn't done by a machine.
Yeah. Now, with some of the outside shapes, if I'm able to find a template that I like and will work with my designs, I do have a press and pancake dies that will punch out the outer shape, but everything else inside is hand done.
Well, and that's important because you want, you're working with the edges of the barrette of the metal, you know, right? You know, to get it right. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. It's beautiful.
Perfect circles are easier when you punch them.
I can understand that. So then you just keep layering that then, and then you don't have to put that in the kiln then. Is that correct?
That does go in the kiln. Good question. So right now I could easily rub it off when it's wet or dry. The nice thing about these special watercolor enamels is it then, well, not like it is now. I wouldn't have the barrette glued onto the back or anything like that. But it will go back into the kiln to a different temperature. When I do the base enamel, that fires in the kiln up to like 1600 degrees, which I tell kids that's like 3 or 4 times the temperature you cook chicken at. And they just like look at me like, that sounds like a lot. And it is. It's pretty hot. So then when I refire, it's at a lower temperature, I think around like 1300 1350, and for a brief moment, like as soon as it starts to fuse, I bring it out and it'll be a nice vibrant color. The longer it sits in there, the muddier it gets, so it's a trial and error. You gotta just keep peeking in there and see how it looks, but it's all fused into that base enamel then, so it won't rub off.
So about how long do things normally stay in your kiln then?
Actually, not very long. I would say a couple minutes at most.
Okay, so that's
a very fast process.
Unlike our pottery friends, you know, I mean, they're in there for a much longer time.
Or like glass blowing artists where they put it in, well, they don't put it into a kiln, but they put it into a kneeler. And that kind of brings down the temperature nice and slow so it doesn't shatter. This, it doesn't happen with this. And this is the buildup layer too for thickness of the glass. So it's nice and strong.
So this gets hot fast and then you cut it off.
Fairly fast. Within, I would say maybe at the most 5 minutes. And it because when I open the kiln door, the temperature drops. So I have a digital gauge on it that helps. And once it gets up to temperature, and then I just like wait a little bit and I peek in. And then as soon as I see it's fused and shiny and smooth, and I take it out. There are other steps before that that you can keep as well. The first step is like, I'm going to say it's sugar coat, where it's still got the grain and sparkle, but it is stuck to the metal. So you can keep that kind of layer. And then next one is onion peel, where it's kind of melted, but it's a little, got a little wave to it. And then fully fused, which is the step that I use, is when it's perfectly glass smooth.
Yeah. Oh my goodness, you're giving us such a great education. I mean, you know, there's so much that goes into your
there
beauty.
There is.
Pieces. You know, it's like, this is very good, Angela. Thank you so much. You keep going.
Keep going. Did you have any other questions about anything? You have great questions.
Well, no, I mean, you helped us very much with that, you know, understanding that process, you know, and it is quite a process, you know, when you look at, and I just look at the pieces that you do and they're so beautiful. They're so tiny, you know, you make some of the most tiny things that I've ever seen, you know, like your little leaf. I could hardly, so dainty. It's just so precious. Yeah. But were you going to show us were you going to do a little hammering for us? Can you do that? Or
I don't know how well the textures will show on my camera.
Okay. Well, that's fine.
I will quick show that different hammers create different textures. So like in this sense, this little nub here would make a really, really small indent. Can you see the different textures? Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The teeny tiny little dots. It has to do with the surface contact. So if it's a really small area, it would create a really fine little dot. And that's what I use on my pieces mostly. And each little dot is a blow with the hammer.
Wow.
This makes bigger dots. And something like that makes like little linear stripes.
Mm-hmm.
So it's fun to experiment with textures.
Mm-hmm. Again, you develop the amount of pressure that you have to use, or
right. Mm-hmm. You can buy metal in different hardnesses. You can buy like really soft. You can buy it half hard or fully hard. So that's kind of nice too, because like if you want to bend it, you want it to be forgiving. And you can anneal metal with a flame and soften it. It kind of like loosens up the particles and the molecules of the metal. And then as you work it, you work hard on it, and it becomes more strong. And then once you get beyond that point, that's when it breaks.
Oh.
So that's when it went too far, when it starts like splitting.
Oh, okay. And so then when you purchase your metals in sheets, right?
Right.
I mean, what size sheets are those? Or do you get them really big? Or
You can buy them in all kinds of lengths, sizes, and gauges, which is like the thickness. Mm-hmm. I tend to get them in like 6-inch by 12-inch sheets as I need them.
Yeah.
When I first started designing, I called it my garden collection. That was just strictly daisies with all kinds of different shapes, outside shapes and, jewelry styles of how it was like spaced out like this, spaced out or close together, or this football type shape. Or just the teardrop shape.
Mm-hmm.
So I was playing around with just a collection as a whole with just the one daisy design. And then after a while, I kind of branched out from there, playing around with like the sunflower or the mom, or I'm trying to think what else I have. Sunflower, dahlia,
did we
clover,
see the mom?
Shamrock type shape.
Did we see the mom?
This is an example of the mum. It's just a bunch of like flat oval ones.
Gotcha.
Because I painted it green, I call it more of a succulent.
Uh-huh.
So it can go either way. And that's where the color kind of helps too, where I can dictate like what kind of flower I want it to be or what season I want it to be worn in. So this might be a fun summery piece.
It reminds you a little more Southwest, you know. I mean, you know, so that
that's got like the leather cord. Uh-huh. So I got that. And I also have bracelets that I sell. And here's a variety of styles. With
and you do the nice leather. Yeah. Tell us about that.
This is similar to what you had for your daughter.
Yep.
It's a basic wide band, and it's got this stainless steel clasp, which I love. It's a clip and hook.
Mm-hmm. So it's nice. It stays nice and taut. It's, you don't worry about losing it.
Right. And it's snug around your wrist.
Mm-hmm.
So I love that. I experimented with other bracelet techniques. This was like the first thing that I played around with, which was the sizable slider knots, which can be a little tricky. So I'm slowly kind of discontinuing those and just making them if they're special requested.
But I think a lot of I was going to say younger, older, you know, I mean, you like the leather look. It gives it it's a little more casual.
Yeah, more earthy too. It goes great with the theme.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, so that's really pretty. And then we saw your daisies, right? You know, that was
this design. This is the daisy. Daisy. This one, this is another one. This is a poppy flower. It's got like a little wavy.
Oh yeah, I see that.
Mm-hmm. This is kind of more like a black-eyed Susan because it's got the one hole in the center. Mm-hmm. If it's got multiples, I call it a sunflower.
Flower.
Here's a white mum.
Yeah. And that was from the garden collection, right?
Yep, garden collection is basically the whole nature theme that I'm currently playing with. I may get into geometry shapes later on, but for now that's the garden collection. And then I have like sub collections with the different finishes, the hammer, the patina, the enamel, the watercolor enamel. And then you can also search on my website based on the flower style. I have those listed as menu options as well.
Yes. Now you said that, unfortunately, you know, this year due to our COVID-19, we haven't had too many shows. I mean, all of ours have been canceled. I believe all of yours. But you do you have one that is still hanging in there for you that's coming up?
Currently, I do. It's next month in September. It's a Saturday and Sunday show, 19th and 20th. It's part of the county studio tour. They have a variety of counties that they hold a studio tour that you drive from studio to studio within that county. And it's held at a studio in that county, but then that host artist can have guest artists from other counties as well. So I'm not located in Chester County, but I will be a guest artist at a Chester County studio during this tour. And it's in Spring City Mill Studios in Spring City, PA. And I'm looking forward to it, but
yeah, you didn't hear anything on that. And you said that you had here, you make a county collector?
Correct.
Well, you wanted to talk about county collector, so let's...
Yes. So part of the county studio tour is a county collector that every artist has to make. And offer it at a discounted price of only $75. I don't know if you can see that. That says $75.
Oh, okay.
It's normally $110. And it comes in a 6x6 frame. So you can actually hang this or wear it. It's your choice. But this time, this is my third collector I've done, the third time I've done the show.
Yeah.
This one is unique from the others because not only is it watercolor enameled, black on white. It's, you might be able to see it. It's also got like a crackle effect. So it's got some texture and it's got some crackly lines. It's not cracked. It's just crackled with the layer of the watercolor on top of the base. So it's got that fun texture going. So that would be offered if the show isn't held. Last time, it's actually rescheduled for May. So if it's not held again in September, this will be available to purchase on the website.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, this has been an unusual year. We, you know, unfortunately, our Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen, our show this year that was scheduled for October 31st and November 1st at Kutztown University. We got word that the university can't have any outside events, you know, for 2020. So we just got word of that, and we're sad, you know, but, you know, we need to keep our patrons and our craftspersons safe, and that's the foremost thing. So we are assured though that they're keeping us in mind. Of course, they'll get in touch with us for 2021, and we'll be back at Kutztown University in the fall again. You know, that either that first weekend in November or the last weekend in October, they'll get back to us, you know, with that, you know.
Good.
But right now we're just trying to, you know,
go with the
flow, right? You know, but it does give us time to, as artists and craftsmen, to do things, you know, because obviously what else can we do? We're not out getting to see our public. So we're lucky in that respect, you know, that we can experiment with different things, which, you know, you have done, and you'll keep on doing that, you know, and I know my husband, we've been doing that as well, you know, but like I said, as craftspersons, we're fortunate in that respect that, you know, we're stuck in our studios, you know, so we can't say we didn't have enough time.
Right. I even dabbled in the fiber arts. I was making masks in like March and April, or April, I think most of April into May. And then it was like, oh, Mother's Day is coming up. So then I updated my website, finally got everything up on there. So yeah, now's the time to browse online, because my everything pretty much that I would take to a show is now available online. If it says sold and you love it, just let me know. I can remake it. I do also accept custom orders. I've done a variety of fun pieces. If we have a few minutes, I'm just going to show you a couple that include my pop-up style, at least, that were custom ordered and special. Some of them are really special, memorable pieces.
Okay, yeah.
This is a simple one, and I'm showing you a picture because I don't have it.
Yeah, sure.
This is a combination of one design that I have that has three petals that's really long earring, and then I have a short one that's one, and I didn't have anything in between, and this person requested that length in between with just two. So there you go. You like, but you want something that's in between, I can customize that.
Right. Just as much as most artists do, you know, I mean, you know, and that's the beauty, again, of speaking with a craftsperson or an artist. They can make it exactly how you envision it as the customer, you know, and they're almost everyone I know who's a member of Reading Berks, and that they will gladly do that.
Right.
Yeah.
This person requested pet tags. It's hard to see, but the little circles hanging from their chains is a little pet tag with a little pop-up heart, and then their name, which is actually a decal. You can do this in ceramics too, on glazes. You buy these special water slide decals, and you can do text. Here's another. This is a beautiful piece I did for a friend whose father had passed. We used the handwriting from a card, and I turned his handwriting into the stem of the flower saying "Love, Dad" with the decal. I love this piece.
that's beautiful.
So there's all kinds of fun things that you can do. Yeah. And then I'll share this last one.
Yeah.
So this is another custom ordered piece. This is the mother's necklace with three different flowers, and then the next three are the coordinating flowers. So you have like the black-eyed Susan, the daisy, and then the sunflower. And then when they are all together, they can match up their flowers. So it's kind of like a friendship, mother-daughter type necklace. If they want to, whenever they're made up, they can match them up and make a whole flower. That's fun.
That's beautiful. Well, you said for your, I'm just going to take you back to your wedding here. You said that you mentioned this at the beginning of our segment here tonight. You did something for your wedding?
I did. It wasn't anywhere near involved as this, because it was actually before I started my business. I got married in 2011. I officially started Serricca Studios in like 2015. But I had like copper spirals, and I spray painted a lot of things copper toned, and I had some like copper jewelry. It was more with like beads and copper wire. And I made like necklaces for my bridesmaids and stuff like that. It was the metallic accent. It was copper as opposed to silver or gold.
Yeah. And but that's kind of what said, I need to get that. That was
yeah. I love photography, but I miss making things with my hands and wearable interactive art pieces that people can feel good wearing. So
yeah,
that's what kind of started the itch again.
I was going to say, I thought so. That's why I had to bring you back to there, because I thought, I bet this is where you got the little itch again, you know, to go back and do this. Well, we're so glad you got that itch.
Thanks. Me too.
Yeah. So I know it's, like I said, it's been a tough year for everyone, you know, as far as, you know, the craftsmen, because I talked to some of the other people, and they say, you know what we miss most? We miss the people, you know,
and the meetings.
Well, you got the thing. We're going to try to have a Zoom meeting for everyone now.
I'm excited.
We're going to see how that goes, right?
How do you know how to Zoom?
Yes. Well, like I said, I can't sing the praises of Zoom. You know, I mean, I know that, you know, sometimes we had a few little glitches, you know, here and there, and one I was sideways, but that's okay. you know, like I said, I got more techie than I've ever thought I would. and you did too, right?
Yep.
You know. But we all keep on learning and learning Zoom, and we all keep on learning our crafts, you know, and stuff. So it's really been good. So you think that your next little venture, what do you think you're going to do next with
Believe it or not, I might start dabbling in diffusing oil, essential oil diffusing jewelry. I have a college roomie friend who sells Young Living, which is an essential oil brand, and kind of turned me on to that idea. So might have something like that in time for the holidays. I've also been wanting to branch out into more sculptural, maybe type pieces, wall decor and whatnot.
Okay.
So we'll see.
Okay.
Possibilities are endless.
So you are thinking about doing some more, you know, making your sculptures a little bigger. You know,
I would like to. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And more art for the home then hanging, you know.
Right. Like, or even if it's still small in a frame and it's just.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Certainly be a statement. Yes. So, okay. Well, let's just say one more time. Anyone can email you, right? At SerriccaStudios@gmail.com, right?
Yeah.
You're going to say that one more time. SerriccA. Can't miss that extra R, that extra C. Okay. And your website, of course, is SerriccaStudios.com. So, and they will be getting in touch with you. Okay. Okay. So thank you so much, Angela.
Thank you.
Everything. It was so nice, you know, to be in your studio today. Okay.
Thank you so much for having me.
Okay. So we will be back next month. Okay. I will find someone who's going to be brave enough, you know, to do this again. And thanks again to you today, Angela. And we will see you all later. Thank you. BCTV, and that's it for Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen, Your Berks Craftsmen. Bye.
Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.